Just how many Earths are out there? Join us as we find out in Earth-like Planet Discoveries. As William Shakespeare once phrased it, "There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy." And he was right. The number of Earth-like planets has just increased manifold over previous estimations. Before we get into that, however, we need to find out just how much we don't know. For example, how many stars are there in the Milky Way? The truth is that we do not know. Here's a thought experiment for you. Imagine you live inside a warehouse full of stuff. The walls are so far away that you cannot reach them in your lifetime. Describe the outside of the warehouse. It can't be done, obviously. You might be able to describe nearby things that are inside with you, but whatever intervenes blocks out many of the farther things, even within the building you inhabit, that are behind them. Even if the walls are transparent from within, you still can't see the outside of the structure. It will remain invisible to you unless you can somehow leave the warehouse. For this reason, images that point out our location in the Milky Way are completely bogus. The image is of a stand-in galaxy that looks a lot like what we think is the structure of the Milky Way. The location indicated for you is just a crude estimate of where we would be if we could see our own galaxy in its entirety. We can't. If that photo was really the Milky Way, the camera would have to have been no less than 100,000 light years away. It was 200,000 years ago that humans first evolved in Africa. If primitive humans had the capability to send a camera at light speed, and it had arrived 100,000 years ago, and taken the picture, then sent the photo back by laser light, it would just be arriving now. We can't do that now, and they certainly couldn't have done that back then. That image is thus an impossibility. Science says the picture is fairly reliable. Even if we think we got the answer more or less correct, we still don't know how many stars are in our galaxy. Until the beginning of the 20th century, we thought the Milky Way was the whole universe. EDWIN Hubble discovered Cepheid variables that let us measure vast distances. And we finally recognized that we are surrounded by billions and billions of other whole, completely separate galaxies. They are so far away that we can barely even distinguish individual stars. A star the size of our Sun would be completely invisible at that distance, contributing only to the general glow. We certainly can't count them. That is why some astronomers say we have 100 billion stars in the Milky Way, while many more suggest 200, 300, or even 400 billion stars. There are plenty of Earths. Current estimates based on our rate of discovery and our notions of stellar and planetary formations indicate that one out of every four stars will have an Earth-like planet in its Goldilocks zone. You have to bear in mind that this is predicted on the, perhaps outdated, notion that there are but 100 billion stars, rather than the other extreme of 400 billion. There are at least 10 billion planets that are Earth-like, but possibly 40 billion, depending on which number of stars in our galaxy eventually turns out to be the most accurate. In one extraordinary case, the TRAPPIST system, its planets D, E, F, and G are all in the Goldilocks zone, where it's not too hot, not too cold, but just right for liquid water to exist. It was named in honor of the Transiting Planets and Planetesimal Small Telescope, or TRAPPIST, located in Chile, after it discovered the planets there. TRAPPIST-1 isn't sun-like at all. Compared to our yellow sun, the TRAPPIST red star is tiny, just a bit bigger than Jupiter, though much heavier. Nevertheless, all of its planets are Earth-sized. It's a red dwarf, very small, relatively cool, has an active surface that may throw off a lot of coronal material, and the planets orbit close and fast. The planets may also be tidally locked, as our moon is to Earth, always showing just one face. If these planets possess a magnetosphere like Earth, the planets could be protected from the coronal mass ejections and harbor life. If not, they could be as nearly airless, arid, and barren as Mars. Irrespective of the eventual result, this tells us that Earth-like planets don't have to circle a star like ours. There are many more possibilities. What qualifies a planet as Earth-like? If a planet is over 75% or less than 150% of Earth's size or mass, it qualifies as an Earth-like planet. That is a very wide range. Within this size and mass range, the gravity would be manageable. Trees or vegetation would be taller on the low gravity version and shorter, sturdier on the higher gravity version. In either case, mass alone doesn't drive surface gravity. It is also dependent on the radius of the planet. The further the surface is from the planet's center, the lower the gravity. This is why tiny Mercury, radius 1500 miles, and Mars, radius 2100 miles, which is twice as heavy, have exactly the same surface gravity of 0.383g. In either case, humans could live on other Earths in the described size ranges with little adaption. Of course, it must also be within the Goldilocks zone. Without the possibility of liquid water, it simply isn't Earth-like. What other Earths are out there? The first discovery by TESS, NASA's Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite, is named TOI-700D. TESS is a space telescope that was launched in 2018, specifically to find Earth-sized planets in the habitable zone of nearby stars. The reasoning is that it should be easier to follow up on such discoveries with optical telescopes from Earth. Currently, astronomers are simulating what TOI-700D could look like. When they start to get real results from observations, these simulations will help them quickly narrow down the category to which the planet belongs. It may be a wet Mars-type planet or a dry Earth, but these simulations will help them quickly decide which it is so they can focus their studies more carefully. Teegarden Star. In mid-2019, we discovered that Teegarden's star had two planets. Interestingly, both are in the Goldilocks zone of this red dwarf, and both are the right size. Teegarden B has a surface temperature between 32 to 122 degrees Fahrenheit, 0 and 50 degrees Celsius. And since Teegarden C is farther out, it should be even cooler. Notably, Earth's average temperature is 58 degrees Fahrenheit, 15 degrees Celsius. Since they are only 12 light years away, we could quickly determine that they were also of the right temperature to sustain not only water, but possibly the conditions for life as we know it. 10 billion Earths in Milky Way. The Kepler Space Telescope discovered over 2,600 exoplanets. Many of them, such as Kepler-62f, Kepler-186f, and Kepler-442b, are extraordinarily far away. The Spitzer Space Telescope has let us examine the atmosphere of some of the newer discoveries. It gives us a whole new view because its observing strength is in the infrared, showing us things we cannot see with the naked eye. The takeaway: we now have nearly 4,300 exoplanets in our records. In the early days, it was just huge planets similar to Jupiter. We've honed our skills and can now identify planets much more like our own. Going back to the Jupiter-sized discoveries are giving us new Earth-like planets with our more sensitive equipment and improved techniques. This return has also helped us prune many prospects from the list that are now known to be too cold, too hot, subject to massive solar flares, and other negating phenomena. Adding or subtracting candidates, it is all progress. We now know that Earth-like planets are relatively common, with approximately one star in four possessing at least one. We have such a backlog of candidates to examine that it will take years just to study them all. It makes sense to focus on the closer ones so that one day we might visit the nearest ones with a reliable catalog of facts in our hands, knowing what sort of atmosphere it has, what temperature it is, and the availability of metals for building things. If we detect gases from biological processes, we would know that there was at least elementary life. If we detect pollution gases, we would suspect there was industry already present. As our instruments improve, we could be bound on the greatest adventure of them all, meeting alien beings. The meek shall inherit the Earth, and the rest of us are going to the stars. Would you live on another Earth-like planet if you could? Let us know in the comments below, and then check out this next video that you might find interesting.